lunch, his hair long and lank, hanging neglected over his face.
He was not just poor, he was also probably a hunchback. But in 1653, he had managed to get a choral scholarship to Oxford.
He was a bit paranoid, as we would say today. He had a chip on his shoulder, but he was fiercely loyal to his friends. He was prickly, he was jealous, he wrote his secrets down in code, but he was a brilliant scientist.
At the age of 27, Hooke was given the apparently lowly job of curator of experiments for the Royal Society. For this he received a small wage and eventually a place to live in the Society's Gresham Street headquarters in London. His skill as an instrument maker meant that he could help devise and construct the increasingly more sophisticated weekly experiments. But Hooke had obsessions of his own. He wanted to see into a world no one had ever seen before.
The world of the 17th century was limited by the naked eye. People knew nothing of the finely divided veins of a leaf, the tiny creatures that teemed in the streams or on the bark of trees, or on our own bodies or in our beds. But all that was about to change. On the tip of my finger is a tiny flea. You almost can't see it with the naked eye at all. And that's the way it was in the 17th century. All people knew about fleas was that they caused itchy red spots and sleepless nights, until Hooke put one under his microscope. This is an extremely precious object. It's one of the very early compound microscopes, dating from the 1670s. It was designed, but not made, by Robert Hooke himself. There would have been a wick there, lit with oil coming from this reservoir here, and this great big bowl of water acted as a large lens, focusing the light through this smaller lens here on the stage where we put a flea. And instead of the oil lamp, we've got a modern torch here, which I'm just going to switch on.
What he saw must have taken his breath away. A revelation from an unknown world.
I can imagine it must have been a wonderful experience for Hooke and people like him to look down a compound microscope for the first time, and it opened up a whole new world of the very small.
Whenever he found something new, Hooke would put it under his microscope, and slowly and painstakingly, he began to draw what he saw. For the first time, we could begin to understand the innermost workings of nature. And in 1665, he published his masterpiece, Micrographia. With its astounding images and Hooke's speculations about the laws that might govern the universe.
It's a most magnificent book. It was an instant sensation. Samuel Pepys stayed up all night reading it, not surprisingly, because it's full of incredible images that nobody had ever dreamt of. This flea, which is an exquisite drawing by Hooke, shows amazing detail. You see all the hairs on the legs, little hooks at the ends of the feet, which are used to cling on to the host. And here we have the most beautiful picture of a fly's head. The way these surfaces of the eye are arranged in beautiful geometric rows. Probably nobody had any idea that there was such precision, such geometric accuracy at the level of the very small. And Hooke was one of the first to see this and to draw it.
It was the birth of microbiology and everything we now know about the workings of all living things.
Wren and Hooke had an obsession in common. Like Wren, Hooke had traced the comet's progress across the skies. He these are the sketches Hook drew in his notebook, struggling to make sense of the comet and its brief trajectory. What was it? Where did it come from? And what made it move across the sky? But Hook and Wren were not alone. Three more men were also watching from the dark. Each was asking the same questions, and each would have to play their part before the mysteries of the universe could be unlocked. The 17th century was an extraordinary time in history. The workings of the natural world were being questioned, and the very foundations of scientific knowledge were being laid down. And it was a small band of brilliant British young men that were at the forefront of this revolution. The Royal Society continued to grow, and so did its ambition. But London was about to come under attack. In 1665, the plague ripped its way across the city. Anyone who could afford it fled to the countryside. And among them was another key member of this small band of scientific brothers.
If I was able to meet one person from the 17th century, I'd want it to be Robert Boyle. He came from one of the wealthiest families in the country, but he had little time for pomp and grandeur. Instead, as a teenager, he wandered the country lanes, making observations about the world around him, driven by an insatiable curiosity.
This is an example of his more esoteric writing. Occasional reflections upon his manner of giving meat to his dog, upon the sight of a fair milkmaid singing to her cow, upon my spaniel's carefulness not to lose me in a strange place, upon the eating of oysters.
This interest in observing and recording everything he saw began to evolve into a rigorous scientific exploration of the natural world. Rather than discovering something through argument, Boyle was more interested in observing nature and drawing his conclusions from what actually happened. He devised experiments, not always sure what he was looking for, sometimes not even what he was looking at. And one subject particularly intrigued him, air.
He wanted to find out what air actually was. What is this strange substance that's impossible to feel, invisible, odorless, and yet surrounds us every day of our lives?
He enlisted the help of the skilled instrument maker, Robert Hooke, and together they built an extraordinary new device.
The air pump. And this is how it works. You move this handle here, which drives the pistons up and down, which sucks air out of the glass bell jar here, called the glass receiver.
Boyle's idea was to study air by seeing what happened when he took it away. This was the first vacuum in Britain. I've updated it slightly so that I can see the extraordinary effects that Boyle would have observed for the first time. Candles went out. Water that was only warm started to boil. And a pig's bladder, filled with air, swelled and then burst. Boyle was fascinated by these dramatic results.